Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Neelakshi Roy, assistant professor from V.G. Vazek College, Mulund, Mumbai. And I'm going to talk about the issues of marriage and domestic violence in the diaspora. As you probably know, marriage is a very, very ancient institution, and Indian marriages do have something very special about them. Indian marriages are extremely endogamous. Endogamy is the practice of marrying within the community or the society or the religion. Even though marriage is really about the homing desire of the man and the woman in the diaspora, there are many barriers and taboos associated with marriage. This video will discuss some of these barriers and taboos and especially concentrate on the very challenging issue of domestic violence. Sociologists say that Indian communities prefer arranging marriages for the young at a community-specific marriageable age. These practices are controlled by and related to status, acceptability, and notions of honor or izzat, which means respectability for men and chastity for women. Desire for modernity and respectability or homing desires are very important to the issue of marriage. These are what link a male-female relationship and also the family with the male and the female concerned, who are all engaged in the project of attaining modernity and respectability. The desperate seeking of multiple aspects of human existence is implied by the term homing desire. It is not only a mythic desire of looking back to a home in the imagination, it incorporates a search for a real, tangible place to claim in a foreign soil, a safe territory of ownership, where fulfillment comes from belonging, from a combined love of self and community, of work, pleasure, romance, a desire for cultural representation, and a need to define political identity. Desire for modernity and respectability or a homing desire is very important. And this is something which is not a mythic desire for looking back to a home in the imagination. It is a new kind of a search for a real or a tangible place to claim in a foreign soil, a safe territory of ownership, where fulfillment comes from belonging, from a combined love of respect and community, of work, of pleasure, of romance, a desire for cultural representation, and a need to define political identity. The women in Indian diaspora communities are the main stakeholders in the growth of the family or community as an identifiable unit. And it falls upon these women of the first and second generation migrant families to maintain the image of the Indian community as successful and their family or biradari as respectable members, both abroad and in the subcontinent. But these are invariably linked with alienation anxieties or other trauma associated with uprooting. One needs friends, relatives, bondings, and acceptance, which a woman struggles to find in her new family. Many short stories or novels by women writers of the diaspora delineate these. They talk about male and female relationship, marriage and heterosexual romance, alternative sexualities, and non-conventional relationships. Authors like Bharati Mukherjee, Jhumpa Lahiri, Atima Srivastava, Suniti Namjoshi, Vayu Naidu, and the writers of the now defunct Asian Women Writers Collective write about these relationships. Western academicians often portray women as the silent, powerless lot who are victims of forced marriages and dowry. They construct fixed ideas of the third world women, but they also control academic writing on them by those scholars who choose to work on them. Very different categories of women are all cast in the image of the tradition-bound average third world woman, who is the opposite of the self-representation of emancipated Western women. In fact, there are many positive attributes and strengths of these women who inhabit several cultural domains at once. The Indian community is found to be successful in adapting to the hostland and keeping cultural roots intact. This puts a double burden on women to maintain traditions at home and to work hard both at home and outside. They need to be called cultural entrepreneurs, rather than victims of arranged and forced marriages, though such cases do happen. Let's talk about some of the positive images of women. There is cultural evidence of their agency that film and other literature affords. Indian women writers and filmmakers show how their protagonists are actively creating agency where it is denied across gendered, racialized, ethnicized, and classed formations of power. Thus, only a multi-level reading of cultural and academic texts can only bring about the idea that married Indian women in the diaspora are also as successful as their male counterparts. They are an active part of this competitive and upwardly mobile force and never passive victims, but leaders of successful communities whose contribution is somehow not recorded. Now we move on to discussing some of the transnational dimensions of marriage. Anxious to preserve purity and transnationally carried values of the native society, the Indians of the older generation often go to great lengths to find partners for their children from back home. Thus, transnational marriage networks across countries and continents are an important aspect of diasporic domestic life. According to research, there are new patterns of transnational marriages that are happening according to the different kinds of migration practices across countries and continents. And these are very important aspects of diasporic domestic life. Marriage practices and affinal relationships keep on getting transformed in the process of migration and diaspora. Of course, many second generation youth are preferring today intercaste own choice marriages, but interreligious and interrace marriages are less frequent. In interracial marriages, choosing partners from the white or Asian mainstream is still more popular than marrying people of African origin. Gurinder Chadha's film Bhaji on the Beach is an important film related to this subject. She talks about class, race, religion, and caste issues of marriage in the diaspora community, just like she does in her film Bride and Prejudice. Now let's talk about the importance of endogamy in diaspora marriages. Endogamous marriages not only continue the bloodline through, but also secure the domestic environment to socialize the children into the group's own values. There are problems with partners coming from the subcontinent. These subcontinental partners go abroad carrying cultural practices that may be in conflict with those of the host country. In all countries, the Indian community is endogamous to the point of practicing racism in the selection of spouse profiles. Perhaps an attitude of open support for endogamy conceals a suppressed fear or hatred of the other, both on the part of the older and the younger generation in selection of partners. Alongside class compatibility, race and culture are thus two other factors which inhibit interracial alliances. There are taboos and barriers about other cultures. One of the major reasons for arranged marriages arise out of the set of taboos held close by each community. Members of the black races and the dominant white are both disqualified on account of class and cultural difference more than skin color or race by the Indian community. Many of these examples can be found in cultural texts like the films Mississippi Masala, Bhaji on the Beach and Bend It Like Beckham. Negative stereotyping produces inhibitions in both communities about forming permanent bonds. The first credential for arranging a marriage in the diaspora community is to look for the same religious affinity. The next criterion for matchmaking would be caste. The regional barrier is another strong one which works against alliance formation, and above all else, class plays another crucial discriminating factor in the choice of partners in Indian marriages. Arranged marriages are often thought of as based on corporate kinship interests, in contrast to love marriages based on romantic attachment between the couple. In India and its diasporas, marriage is often a key vehicle through which a family status is improved or expressed. Though there may be other factors involved in weighing the attractions of a particular match. This logic is extended in transnational marriages also, with the benefits of immigration and citizenship, like the green card, or permanent residency, a PR, providing additional motivations. Thus, class aspirations are negotiated through the marriage alliance. Hard work and frugal habits and the Indian family as a social unit aspires to the upper classes. In tune with the project of upward growth, the first generation immigrant focuses on earning, saving, and transferring funds to the transnational family. And then, after gaining foothold in the host country, relocates the family. Soon, the members of the family start earning to support the increase in the domestic budget. And as basic needs are met, demands for tangible goods associated with prosperity are bought, like a washing machine, a television, and other consumer durables, followed by a house, a car. And then there is the sending of the children to private schools, though all the time maintaining frugal habits. It is this middle class which often gets some of these items gifted by the bride's family or paid for in cash as dahej, daj or dowry as in South Asian marriages. There are wide Asian and transnational networks and marriage bureaus or internet services for arranging marriages like www.bharatmatrimony.com, www.vivaha.com and community-specific sites like www.bengalmatrimony.com, which have evolved into convenient methods of spouse selection across national barriers, spanning countries and continents. You can see a typical ad for an NRI groom or an Indian bride for an NRI groom. To move on to other ideas related to the domestic space, Gayatri Spivak in her essay In Other Worlds highlights how women's bodies in the diaspora continue to be used for their reproductive labor as well as outside, as the bodies of Indian women back home. The average Indian looks for ways to increase the family income by the involvement of every member of the family, including the women, and they take for granted women's labor. They are the ones silently working behind desks and counters, corner shops, motels and groceries, or sewing till their eyes ache and backs hurt in sweatshops owned by ruthless owners. They also go to school, college and work in corporate offices, the media, culture and in government sectors. Over and above all this, they are the ones who are performing reproductive labor, cooking, cleaning, washing at home, along with bearing and nurturing children. Marriage is the official sanction for control over women's labor, sexuality and fertility, like this senior lady working in possibly a Gujarati-owned corner shop in the UK, which is stacked with groceries, and she attends to customers from morning till evening, while she goes home and attends to her own grocery shopping, and she cooks, cleans up the kitchen, gets prepared for the next day, and then comes back to the shop again, working for the whole day till late into the evening, when possibly her daughter comes to relieve her at the shop. In the second visual, you can see some women working in a sweatshop. Most of them are of Asian origin, as you can see, producing garments per piece for which they are paid per piece rather than their long hours back-breaking work which they do throughout the day, day in and day out. In the last case, you see a woman at a desk who is attending calls, etc. The same fate awaits her. She goes home and she cooks and cleans, looks after the child and does the shopping and everyday care of the family, and then she comes back the next day to perform her duties at work. Domestic violence and honor killings. Thus, the lifestyle of the woman in the diaspora, especially after marriage, is not substantially very different from the lifestyle of the woman back at home in India. But domestic violence is a very, very serious phenomenon. It is a global phenomenon that cuts across nation, religion, race and class. Yet the specific situation in the Indian diaspora, where brides are often brought from the homeland and are relatively powerless in a new and alien environment, gives rise to deeply traumatic experiences for women in the marital home. There are also numerous cases where the man comes back to the homeland, marries a woman from there, and then abandons her while he himself returns to the hostland, possibly to marry someone again, either from the community or from someone outside of the community. Despite their labor, even today in the 21st century, there are records of a staggering amount of Asian women who are mentally unstable or are declared so by their husbands and the psychiatric units dealing with them. Many are targets of domestic violence, abuse, dowry problems and other types of victimization. Shamita Das Dasgupta writes that as early as 2004, approximately 12,000 abandoned women live in Gujarat. They have been married abroad and they have returned. And that 25,000 wives of NRIs have been deserted in Punjab. She adds that in Punjab, nearly 20,000 unsolved court cases are there against NRI husbands for abandoning their wives. 2 out of 10 men abandon their wives in Canada. That is, 2 out of 10 men of Indian origin. Canada has at least 10,000 runaway grooms. More than 30,000 women in India have been abandoned by NRI husbands in different locations. Indian women's torture at their husbands' hands often goes unpunished by law. There are also horrible cases of child abuse, child molestation, rape and torture in the host country, where families are more isolated and the society more unobtrusive. No one would really become very concerned if there are sounds coming from a neighboring house, for example. In the USA, dowry deaths are not as frequently reported as honor killings is. In the UK, citizenship laws are so strict that there are many violations among Indian aliens or those without work permits. And among them, such crimes are common. Canadian police is doing a heavy crackdown on this issue. An Australian law is actively trying to give every Australian the right to live in peace and therefore looking at mysterious deaths among Indian communities with great care. Abandonment, abduction and declaring lunacy are other cruelties perpetrated on women. And many writers and organizations like Sakhi, Southall Black Sisters, Manavi, etc., are the first organizations in the US to focus on violence against South Asian immigrant women. They have long fought against these crimes and are still fighting. The only question is that the crimes have to be reported to them. Honor killings are another great bane, and the UK is one of the places where honor crimes are really great. 28,000 honor crimes reported by the police annually, of which 12 deaths are an average in 2013. In a study conducted in 2010, 33 honor killings happened, mostly in North America and 67 in Europe, to Muslim women of various origins. It is indeed astounding to think that liberated and developed societies like those in the West allow some of its citizens to be brutalized in the name of privacy, incompatibility, mistake, or cultural problem. Such violence often lurks under the untold stories of Indian women's lives even in the 21st century, as the Kiranjit Ahluwalia case does, till the film Provoked was made by Jag Mundra. The link found on Facebook about the real life story of Sarabjit Kaur Atwal might be a useful one to follow. It is there on your text on the website of EPG Pathshala. Some questions that are raised are very interesting to discuss. Changes in international advocacy, law and policy are required to ensure justice and a viable life, especially to women in this situation. The question is, who is going to bring about the change? The Canadian Council of Muslim Women wants Canadians to change the expression honor killing to one they think is more appropriated, femicide, because they say that there is no honor to killing women. In Canada, many Muslim organizations are trying to stop these deaths. There are many advantages of staying in a new country. You must be wondering whether marrying out of the country is secure or not. Many women's groups in the Middle East and Southwest Asia suspect that the victims are at least 4 times the United Nations' latest world figure of around 5,000 deaths a year. One wonders, why is there so much secrecy over such deaths? Is that the ethnicity of a woman that prevents immediate police intervention, especially in the diaspora? We must understand that if there is misunderstanding of or lack of communication between the husband and the wife, and if there are issues regarding material upliftment or material ambition, there is likely to be conflict. But this is not true only of the diaspora. Similar conditions can happen even in the homeland. Thus, conflict of material interest or material ambition is one of the most important causes for domestic violence. And unhappy marriages can only be helped by the community or by the elders who are standing as vanguards of the culture and of the social fabric. This is why diaspora marriages often become very, very troublesome and irksome for the couple concerned. However, there is always the opportunity of the victim to get attention from organizations which help to intervene in these cases. The issue is that the person who is concerned, that is the victim, usually the woman, must approach these organizations. If he or if she does not approach this organization, nothing can really be done. Similar is true of the condition back home. In case such kinds of unhappiness or difficult situations arise, then similar fate will await the woman concerned. Thus, is there much difference between the world situation that a woman enters by choice when she decides to marry abroad and the woman who remains back at home? One wonders whether, you know, the picture of happiness or the dream becoming fulfilled is really a genuine picture or not? Is it a realistic picture? One begins to question this and the very basis of this. There are also other issues concerned. Every time that new laws are made regarding migration and settlement, there are new kinds of infringements of these laws. It seems as if there are people looking out for catching victims who are poorly conversant with law and to perpetrate cruelties which are not even heard of in otherwise in our international forums. However, what is also true is that there are very, very happy marriages and no domestic violence in many of the cases of the marriages. And thus, it's only a situation or the outcome of some kind of a misunderstanding or mistreatment that often leads to domestic violence and brutality. Not that every marriage is a potentially dangerous marriage when one settles abroad and marries. As we discussed, there is a very high proportion of this because of the material ambitions of many Indians who are settled abroad. Otherwise, the marriages that are abroad or the marriages in India are not very different from each other. They can be just as happy and successful as one wishes that they were.